Every person in our world is heading toward eternal life or eternal death. Bible prophecy tells us we are living in the last days of Earth's history, when every person's eternal destiny is to be decided. The purpose of Steps to Life Television is to help you make the decisions you must make if your destiny is to be eternal life.
In the very last days of this Earth's history, according to Bible prophecy, only a relatively few people in the world will be worshiping the Creator. The vast majority of people in our world will be worshiping something or somebody that the Creator made. The question is, how will you be able to tell the difference between the two groups? Well, to investigate this question, we must look into Bible prophecy again. Let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to read. Father in heaven, we thank you for Bible prophecy that tells us what is going to happen and how to get ready for it. And we earnestly pray that as we read from your holy book, that your Holy Spirit will teach us the truth so that we might know how to be ready for the future. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's free book offer is entitled, The Two Marks. To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer TTM. In the final generation, there are two marks, the mark of God and the mark of the beast. Do you know the difference between these two marks? To receive your copy of The Two Marks, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer TTM. And now, Pastor John Grosboll.
In 1 Chronicles 16:26, the Bible writer informs us, he says, "All the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens." You read something very similar in Psalm 96, verse 5. It says, "For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens." The peoples of the world were worshiping the sun. They were worshiping the sun, the moon, and the stars. They were not worshiping the Creator that made the sun, the moon, and the stars. We have delved into in previous programs some detail about sun worship and the evil results that came of sun worship. But that's the way it was in Old Testament times. The children of Israel worshiped the true God. They worshiped the one true God, the Creator of the heavens and the earth. That distinguished them from all other peoples. In the book of Jonah, when Jonah, you know, was the runaway prophet, and he tried to run away from the Lord, and there was a storm on the sea, they came to him, and they said, this is what they said to Jonah in chapter 2. It's chapter 1. They came to Jonah, and they said, "Who are you, and who do you worship?" And this is what he said, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." That was different than the gods they were used to worshiping. And Jonah said, "I worship the Creator. He's the one that made the heavens and the earth." And so that distinguished the children of Israel from all other peoples, because the other peoples were worshiping the sun. And although that was their main deity, they worshiped the moon too, and they worshiped the stars too, and they used different animals and creatures to represent these things that they worshiped in the heavens. So you could distinguish between God's people and the other people in the world by God's people worship the one true God, and the other people, they worship all these different idols. But the time came when the situation became much more complicated than this, because there were several large groups of people in the world who all claimed to be worshiping the one true God, each group claiming that they were the only true religion worshiping the one true God. For example, in the early Christian centuries, number one, there were what were called the Neo or New Pagans, new paganism, neo-paganism. And these people claimed to worship only one God. They had idols, but they said, "No, we only worship one God. We don't worship many." Then number two, there were the Jews. They were also claiming to be the only people in the earth that were worshiping the one true God in heaven. And number three, then there were the Christians. They also were claiming to be the one group of people that were worshiping the one true God in heaven. And as time developed, there developed a number of other large groups, which we have still today. For example, the Muslims or the Islamic people, they all claim that they are worshiping the one true God, and they are the true worshipers of the one true God. So here's the question. You got all these groups all claiming that they're worshiping the one true God. The question is, who is really worshiping the Creator, and who is worshiping something created? Who is worshiping something that God created, and who is worshiping the Creator? How can you tell the difference? You see, there are people that think they're worshiping the God of heaven, but they're actually worshiping the sun god, or they're worshiping an angel, or they're worshiping a group of human beings. Now, the Bible gives us some definite rules to help us determine whether the God we worship is really the Creator. The Bible acknowledges that there are many gods and lords that are worshipped. This is what the Apostle Paul says about it. In 1 Corinthians 8, he says, even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as there are many gods and many lords. He says, there are many gods and there are many lords. But to the Christian, how many gods and how many lords are there? Let's read a few texts. How can you tell who you worship? Look what it says in Deuteronomy, the 11th chapter, verses 27 and 28. It says, behold, I set before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today, and the curse, if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside from the way which I command you today, to go after other gods which you have not known. Now notice, the way you tell, according to Deuteronomy 11, the way you tell whether a person is actually worshiping the true God or whether they're worshiping something else is, are they obedient to God's commandments? That's the way you tell. Now notice what Jesus said about this. Jesus said something very interesting that I've pondered many, many times in Luke, the 6th chapter, verse 46. Luke, the 6th chapter, verse 46. Jesus says, but why do you call me Lord, Lord, and you do not do the things which I say? Why do you call me Lord, but you're not obedient? Why do you call me Lord, but you don't do the things that I say? That doesn't make any sense. Is Jesus the Lord of your life? If Jesus is really the Lord of your life, then you're going to obey whatever he says. If you don't obey what he says, he's not really your Lord. You're just playing games. You're just playing religion. In Romans, the 6th chapter, the Apostle Paul talks about the very same thing. Here in Romans 6:16, this is what he says. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves or servants to obey, you are that one's slaves whom you obey, whether of sin to death or of obedience to righteousness? Paul says, it's who you are obedient to that determines your destiny, whether death or life. It's who you're obedient to that makes the difference. So, the issue in the last days of this earth's history is going to be the issue of worship. And all the world will claim to be worshiping the one true God. You'll have people of all different religions claiming to be that they're worshiping the one true God, while at the same time that they're claiming that they're worshiping the one true God, they are going to attempt to force other people to worship an image, as we studied in a previous program, Revelation 13:15. Well, let's think about that for a moment. How are you going to be able to tell who is actually worshiping the true God and who thinks they're worshiping the true God, but they're actually worshiping somebody else? Revelation 14:6-7 gives us this command. This is given to people, especially in the last days, the time when God's judgment comes. It says, Revelation 14:6-7, I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come, and worship Him, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and springs of water. Now, there's something very interesting there in the last part of that verse. That passage, the last part of Revelation 14:7, contains a quotation right out of the Ten Commandments. It says, Worship the one who made, worship the one who made the heavens and the earth. That's a quotation right out of the Ten Commandments. Let's read it right out of the Ten Commandments. This is what is quoted in Revelation 14:7 when we're told to worship God, the one that made. Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11. It says, Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work. You, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your manservant, nor your maidservant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. Now notice the 11th verse. This is the verse that is quoted in Revelation 14:7 in the first angel's message to the inhabitants of the earth in the last days. It says, For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. That's a quote, that is quoted, that verse is quoted in Revelation 14:7. In the first angel's message, that it says it's going to go to the entire world. The angel says, Worship him that made the heavens and the earth and the sea and the springs of water. He quotes right out of the middle of the fourth commandment. Do you believe that that's an accident, or do you think it is significant that the angel that comes to the world with the announcement of God's judgment quotes from the fourth commandment and says, Worship the one that made? And where is it in the Bible that we're told the one that made? Well, it's the fourth commandment where it says that in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that in it is, and rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. All right? The fourth commandment is the one commandment of all the Ten Commandments that identifies exactly who is giving this law. You know, a law doesn't have any force except for the person that gives it. For example, what gives force to a law in the state of Kansas? Well, what gives force to a law in the state of Kansas is the government of the state of Kansas. And so when the governor signs it, then that law has the force, the power of the state of Kansas behind it. A federal law has the force of the federal United States government behind it. And when there is a national law passed and the president of the United States signs it, what gives that law force or authority? It's the government behind it. What gives the Ten Commandments authority? Have you ever thought about that? You say to some young person, they say, well, the commandments says you shall not commit adultery. And they say, well, who said so? Well, what is it about the seventh commandment or any other commandment that gives it force, that gives it authority? Well, what gives it authority is who gave it. What gives a force or authority to a law by the state of Kansas is the government of the state of Kansas. What gives force or authority to a law of the United States government is the authority or the power or the force of the United States government. What gives authority to the Ten Commandments? Well, what gives authority to the Ten Commandments is the one that gave the Ten Commandments says, look, I'm the one that made everything. I made the heavens and the earth, the sea and everything. I made it in 6 days. And I rested on the seventh day, and so you need to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The fourth commandment is the one commandment that identifies explicitly who it is that is giving this law. And it says that the Ten Commandment law is given by the Creator of the heavens and the earth. And the Bible says that this is a sign that you are God's chosen people and that you are worshiping Him, that you are His because you are keeping His commandments. Notice how clear the Bible is about this. In Exodus 31, here's what it says. It says, "Speak also to the children of Israel, saying, Surely my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you. You shall keep the Sabbath, therefore, for it is holy to you." And then it talks about doing work in 6 days, and it says in verses 16 and 17, "Therefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And when he had made an end of speaking with him on Mount Sinai, he gave Moses 2 tablets of the testimony, tablets of stone, written with the finger of God." Notice, the Sabbath is a sign. It is a sign of who you are really worshiping. If you're a Sabbath keeper, that is a sign that you are worshiping the one who made the heavens and the earth in 6 days and rested the seventh. You are God's chosen people because you are keeping the fourth commandment. And the sign that God's people will have in the last days is that they keep the commandments. That's the sign of God's people in the very last days. Is the way you distinguish who's really worshiping the Creator and who's not is who is obedient to the Creator's laws. Look at it in Revelation 12:17. It says here, the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And again, in Revelation 14, verse 12, it says, "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." Over and over again, it tells us that the sign of God's people in the very last days will be the people that are obedient, the people that keep His commandments. And actually, when you think about it, does it make sense to say that you're a worshiper of the God of heaven? You're worshiping the Creator of the heavens and the earth, but you will not keep the sign that He has given to show that you believe that He's the one that created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Well, people say, well, I don't want to hear all this about the law. I want to hear about love. I want to read to you what the Apostle John said about love in 1 John, the 5th chapter. 1 John, the 5th chapter. It says, verse 3, "This is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous." But what is going to be happening in the last days is that people are going to be worshiping somebody or something else other than the Creator. That's what the vast majority of the world's inhabitants will be doing in the last days. Stay tuned, and I'll read it to you right out of Revelation 13 and 14.
Bible prophecy has accurately predicted the future of churches and nations hundreds and thousands of years in advance. Bible prophecy is the only dependable guide to what is really going to happen in the future and how to get ready for it. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence Course lessons will help you understand Bible prophecy and Bible teaching about how you can be ready for the future. These lessons can be sent to your home without cost to you, or you can study the lessons online. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH to enroll, or log on to our website at www.stepstolife.org.
Welcome back. In the very last days, people of this world will claim that they're worshiping the God of heaven, but they'll actually be worshiping somebody else, something that is made and not the Creator. Notice how clear the Bible is about this. In talking about the very last days, it says in Revelation 13, verse 8, "All who dwell on the earth will worship Him whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world." And again in verse 15, "He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed." And then notice God's response to this. In Revelation 14, 9 to 12, it says, "Then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, If any man worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand," notice the problem is they're worshiping somebody else other than the Creator, "he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name." Notice the problem is who they're worshiping. Now notice what it says in verse 12. "Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus." All right, notice what makes the difference. What makes the difference as to who you're worshiping? Everybody claims that they're worshiping the true God, that they're the true religion worshiping the true God. But what makes the difference? Who you're really worshiping is the person that you are obeying. If you're really worshiping the true God, it says here in verse 12, you'll be one of those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. The last days are going to be just like it was in ancient times. Throughout Old Testament times, during the time of the lion, the bear, the leopard, and the ten-horned iron beast in Daniel 7, the world, through the influence of sun worship, was breaking every commandment of God's law, but especially the first four commandments, and it is going to be that way again. Because Jesus said in Matthew 24 that in the last days there would be a time of great lawlessness. People will be breaking all 10 of the 10 commandments, but especially the first four, and violating the fourth commandment will be almost universal again, just like it was in the days of Noah and in the time of Nimrod. But there will be a remnant of the woman's seed. This was predicted clear back in the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis 3. Genesis 3, 15. This is what happened the same day that Adam and Eve sinned, the same day that our first parents fell from their innocence, and sin was introduced to the world. This was what was predicted by the God of heaven. Now, Genesis 3:15 is a verse. You need to understand who's talking and who he's talking to. God is the one that's talking, but the person that he's talking to is the devil, symbolized by a serpent, because the serpent was the instrument that the devil used to deceive Eve. All right, so it says, God is talking to the devil, and here's what he says. "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed," that's your descendants, "and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." Notice, it is predicted here that there's going to be a seed of the woman, there's going to be a seed of the serpent. How do you tell whose child you are? If you're a seed of the woman, then you're part of God's true people. If you're a seed of the serpent, you're one of the devil's children, even though you may claim, in fact, the majority of the devil's children claim to be God's children. How do you tell who's telling the truth? When everybody says, "Oh, I'm worshiping the true God," how do you tell who's really telling the truth? How do you tell the difference between who's really a child of God and a child of the devil? When Jesus was here, you can read it in John, the 8th chapter, the Jews claimed that they were the one true people worshiping the God of heaven. Jesus said, "No, not really. You're children of the devil." Why? Because you are lying and plotting murder. And that's breaking two of the commandments. That's breaking the 9th commandment, the 6th commandment. You're breaking the 9th commandment, the 6th commandment. So you're not really the children of God. You're the children of the devil. How do you determine who's really a child of God, who's really worshiping the true God, and who claims to be worshiping the true God, but they're actually part of the children of the devil? Here's how you tell. 1 John 3, verse 8. "He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." Notice, how do you tell who's a child of God and who's a child of the devil? Well, he says, who's the one that sins? What is sin? Sin is breaking God's law, 1 John 3, 4. The one that's breaking God's law, that person is a child of the devil. They may claim to be a child of God. But if you are deliberately breaking God's law when you know it, you're not a child of God, friend. According to the Bible, you're a child of the devil. Read it in your Bible, in 1 John 3, 8. So who are the real children of God? Well, they're the people that are obedient. The people that obey God's laws. So in Revelation 14, when it tells you who God's children are in the last days, it says, Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And interestingly, in Revelation 12, you have language very similar to Genesis 3:15. In Genesis 3:15, it talks about the seed of the woman. That's God's true people, and the seed of the devil. And in Revelation 12:17, it tells you who the remnant, who the last people in the world are, who are the seed of the woman, who are God's true people. Here's what it says. It says the dragon, that's the devil, was enraged with a woman, that's the church, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, the remnant of her seed, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Friend, in the last days, the entire world is going to be divided into two groups. And the deciding factor as to which group that you belong to will be, whose law do you obey? Do you obey God's laws, or do you obey human laws commanding you to violate God's laws? Who do you obey? Remember what it says in James 2. There are some people that said, well, when I went to school, they graded on the curve. My dear friend, God does not grade on the curve. In James' second chapter, it says, whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. Friend, that's going to be where the dividing line is. Do you keep God's commandments, or do you violate God's commandments in order to keep human laws that tell you to violate God's law? That is going to be the dividing line in the very last days. That dividing line will put the entire world, everybody in the world, into two groups. The group that keeps God's commandments and the group that doesn't keep all of God's commandments. If you're alive then, which group will you be in?
We all face one of two different destinies, eternal life or eternal death. We want to help you take the necessary steps so that your destiny will be eternal life. We worship the God who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and rested on the Sabbath. You're invited to worship with us every Sabbath at 11 a.m. Central Time at our chapel at 9330 East Prairie Meadows Circle, Derby, Kansas, on Webb Road, 1/2 mile south of 47th Street, or online at www.stepstolife.org.
We hope you've enjoyed today's program. Today's free book is entitled The Two Marks. To receive your copy, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer TTM. In the final generation, there are only two marks, only two choices, only two consequences. We all must decide who we will obey. Will we obey the God of heaven or the traditions and customs of men? In other words, will we receive the mark of God or the mark of the beast? Our destiny depends on the choice that we make. To receive your free copy of The Two Marks, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for offer TTM. From all of us here at Steps to Life Ministries, may God richly bless you as you seek for His truth.
We hope you are choosing life as your eternal destiny. Steps to Life exists to help people choose life instead of death. We would love to hear from you. You can join us for worship on Saturdays at 11 a.m. Central Time at 9330 East Prairie Meadows Circle, Derby, Kansas. Or write to Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. Or call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Or email us at historic@stepstolife.org. Our web address is www.stepstolife.org.